Brad's Band Concert 1980 for background music. Thank you. grade band playing in the background. I'm sorry, not 8th grade band, band from 1980. Letting down Zay Drive. Pulling Brian behind. You Brad, Brian, and Jimmy, State Park in South Dakota, and then at Whitey's Lake Cabin. Was June of 1978. Brad and Brian had taken the pickup out without permission and were trying to get out of the mud before Grandpa Reuben finds out. We had to wait till the next day before we got it out. Jim, Bev, and family in Excelsior Springs. This was Christmas 1978 as they were on their way through to Florida or on their way back, I'm not sure. The background music is provided by Excelsior Springs Choir. Brad was in this, and that was in 1983 that they were singing this. Julie Hammer. Jim, Alan, Bev, Julie, Wes. And that's Reuben.
Oh,
Brad and Brian splatting on our front steps and front porch, front yard. I'm not sure where this is or where this film clip really belongs. Thought maybe it might be the state capitol up here, but I'm not real sure. It might also be Jefferson City in Missouri. Those shots right there, I'd say it's probably Jefferson City, Missouri. Mud Bowl game in Hutchinson, Minnesota. That's Lloyd with his back to us. Art Gallery, Kansas City Art Institute. It's Brian and Tim. Leanne. Dennis. Must be Greg. Looks like Steve. This is the Doss family picnic. There's Ern and Lena. There's Nellie. Lana's. Ron Brashears. That's Francis Voss in the background. Kevin at bat. Fritz pitching. And Dennis in the outfield there, I think. Francis Voss. Kevin and Brad. It's Ron, Claudia's boy. Lena and Ern. Not sure if that's Ann. Can't really tell. It's Lottie. It's Norman Voss and his boy. Receiving the Len Dawson Scholarship Award at the Chiefs game. The background music, Fortune and Fame, is off the Dreams album. Kane was in the show Dreams. Lenny Dawson being interviewed. Kane and Lamar Hunt coming from the left into the center of the camera. McKeg. Duty McKeg. Aunt Bird. Betty Ola Edelman. Ann Jennings. Carolyn Dawes. That's Carolyn Dawes and then Alanis. Let me see, I gotta catch up here. That's Gary's wife Judy and little girl. Jim's Wife, Gary Gelford, Jim Gelford, Lannis's Boy, Gary and Judy's Girl. You talk about people wherever you go, just talk. This is Snowstorm in Excelsior Springs. You talk about people that you never seen. You talk about. This is a snowstorm of the winter of 78, beginning of 79, so Kane must have received his award in the fall of 78. And these are the boys playing out in front of the house. Houses there now.
Oh, no.
Brad and Brian on the motorcycle. This is Skipper when he was a pup. Brad riding his motorbike up at West High School. This is over by the Presbyterian Church, east of West High School. August of 1979, Dennis and I took a 3-day trip to Silver Dollar City. The boys had gone to South Dakota. To this day, we never have taken them to Silver Dollar City. I don't think dancing and romancing is what these two have in mind. Be that honeymoon look. The Branson Hills, as we go out to Shepherd of the Hills, I believe. On the slides, we know it was just the first time we'd ever seen them. Thank you.
Thank you. travel. horses all over the place. Everywhere you look, you see either a fence or a horse. Wasn't it our Holiday Inn we just passed up there?
Yeah, I think so.
Just tell them that we passed it up.
At 6:11, we passed it up. Now we gotta turn around and go back. We're on our way now. Yeah, we're back on the highway going west this time. We were going east, but now we're going west. So now we're on the... We passed it up, so now we're on the way there.
Leaving Lexington. 7:20 a.m. Hazy again.
Tuesday, July 7th.
Right.
Everyone's wide awake. Well, we're really enjoying the Kentucky scenery despite the fog. We've been climbing and climbing and climbing for the last half hour. Until the fog got heavy enough we couldn't see any scenery, and now we seem to be driving out of it and going down a little ways. We haven't gotten into the Appalachian mountain chain yet. We are currently in the area of Ashland, Kentucky. Now entering West Virginia. Welcome, wild, wonderful West Virginia.
Which is a good waterfall.
We're in the Hawk's Nest area, and we're climbing up and up and up and up, and we
lost my map.
Drove by a picnic area where there was a waterfall, and we went back.
Good waterfall.
Checked it out. And
tell them that me and Jimmy climbed up it.
You're supposed to be spamming.
Well, I climbed up it.
All right, now there's some homemade quilts hanging on from the souvenir stand here. We're still going up in the mountains, hoping to find the end of it, hoping to find a place to have a picnic lunch and some restrooms.
Not hungry.
I say we're about right there.
No.
It's at Hawk's Nest, 3 miles.
They ain't got no Hawk's Nest on us.
Or one and then two.
Elevation 1,360.
Right now?
Yes.
Like I can't even see down.
Hey, what's all these monsters?
Souvenirs. The mystery hole, gift shop, souvenirs.
Check that out.
See the unbelievable.
Van must have a girl in it sometimes.
Like it went down.
That must be it right beside us now.
Now approaching Sewell Mountain, elevation 3,170 feet.
But maybe it's...
This whole road doesn't have speed limits.
I think it's 35 so far. Berlin now.
No, we're not. We are approaching the Maryland state line.
The river is 10 miles away. About a mile.
Now we can now see the Potomac River Bridge. We're still not into Maryland.
We're not on the bridge.
Time is 7 p.m.
We're not on the bridge either.
The road even goes uphill on the bridge.
Cars, oh, wow. 75 cents.
Oh, wow, it does. Look at it. It goes up.
I can't get further. I can't get
Uh-oh.
There.
Wait till you get there, you stop.
Oh man, it's big. It's big.
Jimmy, are you using the movie camera? You can see the ship out there to the right?
Sure, that's what I'm going on. Can't see it. Under the ship.
There's a ship going right under the bridge that we have to go up and over.
Even though them things are going past?
Sure. Look at the big ship going. Look at the big ship going under here. Run the movie camera, Jimmy, and see if you can see it coming through there.
Well, don't waste it all. We gotta get that ship.
There's one right under.
She had an oil mine out there.
About
13.
Did that oil mine?
See that oil mine?
I can't even see it. Where's that?
They got a boat.
The rim's too high.
Yeah.
When we get up here, we should be able to see down.
7 feet.
Can't just drive a boat.
Shucks.
Oh,
really? It looks deep.
big boat.
It's coming on this side of it.
Bet you might have sucked us almost to 3 feet.
It's only a tugger, isn't it?
Can you go ahead and try shooting it before Brian has to get to it? Okay.
It was 90-some-odd degrees when we got here Tuesday evening, and it's 96 mid-afternoon on Wednesday. Troy worked until 10 o'clock Wednesday and had the rest of the day off. Carol worked all day. Troy took Dan and the boys out to the naval base about 10:30. We had lunch when they came back, and we left here about 12:30. And went to Solomon, which is an island on the Chesapeake Bay, and we went through a museum there with boats and boat making and sea diving equipment, and they had a lighthouse that had been restored that we were able to take a tour on. The boys caught jellyfish and crabs in the bay. We came back home about 3 or 3:30 to get a roast in the oven for Carol so that we'd have supper going when she came home from work. Snoopy missed us while we were gone. She had jumped up and pulled the curtain off the front door of the trailer, so we had to go out and buy some chain so we can chain her out in the yard when we leave from now on. 9:30 p.m. Wednesday. We just got back from a trip to the beach area out by the Navy base. We all went wading out into the water. The boys were playing with the jellyfish and said they saw a stingray come up near the beach area. We saw a lighthouse actually out in the water, not operating, but an old one that may be restored later on. The waves and the tide was really starting to come in when we left about 9 o'clock. Then we made a stop at Baskin Robbins ice cream before coming home. Thursday was pretty much a relaxing day. Carol had to work. Troy worked in the morning, came home for lunch, and then he and Dan went up to the club for a party of some sort in the afternoon. The kids played real good until the guys got home about 4 o'clock. Played the game of life and played with some Lego building blocks, and then we just spent the evening at home resting and relaxing. Friday morning was up early, about 5:30 or 6 o'clock, so everybody could get out of here by 8 o'clock. Not everybody. Carol had to work on Friday, but Troy and the rest of us took two cars and went up to Washington. We parked at the West Potomac Park
And we got on one of the tour buses. I was wishing I had the recording along to record the tours so that they would match up to the movies and pictures that we took. But I didn't think ahead soon enough on that. Our first tour was out to Arlington Cemetery. The boys were quite impressed with that. And from there we went back to the Lincoln Memorial. And then we went to the park and had a picnic lunch. Then we walked on and got back on one of the tour buses that took us around the Washington Mall. We spent most of the afternoon at the Air and Space Museum. I think we were in there a good 2 to 3 hours, and the boys really enjoyed that. We were pretty worn out by the time we got out of there. We went over to the Washington Memorial and rode to the top of that and got some good pictures of the view of the city from the top of the memorial. And it was, about 8 o'clock by the time we got back to Lexington Park, and Carol had a good spaghetti supper ready for all of us. We got as many as possible into the shower and to bed around 11 o'clock because we had to get up early on Saturday morning so that all of us could go back up towards the D.C. area. And we got out of here again 8 o'clock this morning, which was Saturday morning. First, we went to the city market where the Amish people bring in their things, and it was kind of like a lot of antiques and some fruits and vegetables and a little bit of everything that people bring in to sell. And then we went up and saw Mount Vernon. The temperature the last couple days has been in the 90s, so it's been pretty warm for touring, but we've all survived, gotten pretty tired by the end of the day. After touring Mount Vernon, we went and parked at we stopped at a picnic area along the Potomac River on the way back and had a picnic lunch, and then we went and parked in the West Potomac area that we parked at yesterday, and from there we had quite a walk past the Lincoln Memorial and the Washington Monument and the White House. We stopped so Brian could walk up to the gate as close as he could get to the White House to take some snap pictures. And then we went over to one of the Smithsonian museums. I believe it was American History, if I'm not mistaken. And spent all the rest of the afternoon there until we were worn out. And got back to Lexington Park about 8 o'clock. So far, our plans for Sunday are to rest and relax most of the morning until the kids get restless, and then we'll take it from there. Chuck Steensland called here Wednesday or Thursday, I'm not sure, I think it was Thursday, and has invited us up to spend Monday and Tuesday and also Monday night out on his boat, just to park our things on his boat and walk the mall area. He said he's within walking distance of everything on the Washington Mall during the day, and then in the evening that we'll do some things from there. We called Don Slade from one of the phone booths near the Lincoln Memorial Friday. He hadn't gotten home from work yet, but I talked to his wife, and then I called again today, Saturday afternoon, about 5:30, and he has invited us out to his house for supper Monday or Tuesday night, and the way it looks, we'll probably go out and spend Wednesday night with him and leave from his house Thursday morning if everything works out as planned. Some of Troy and Carol's friends brought some crab meat, steamed crab meat, over Saturday night, so we all got to try some crab meat. Brad thought that was pretty neat to be able to go back and say that he had tasted crab. We are at the Hollow Dome North in Dayton, Ohio. Wednesday evening, we got here about 7:20 after being on the road for 11 hours, and I have some catching up to do from last Sunday. We haven't had the recorder with us all the time. Sunday, about noon, we had lunch, and then afternoon, I guess it was about 1 o'clock, Troy and Carol and all of us drove up to St. Mary's City, which is the second oldest town in the United States, and they had a play enacting the history of the town, which was really interesting, with the old Englishmen dressed in their
old woolen clothes, which were really hot considering it was in the upper 90s, and it was really interesting to watch. There was a boat that used to go out on tours, an old ship there, and they had an outdoor theater that you could go to in the evenings. From there we drove on to Lookout Point, I believe was the name, and it was nice beaches on both sides. There were a lot of people sunbathing and fishing, but again, the jellyfish were so bad that no one could swim. This has been quite a disappointment for the boys because we were really expected to get some swimming time in with all the water in the area. I guess this is just the time of year that the jellyfish are bad, so no one can go into the water. Everyone was pretty pooed out. We had planned to go back out to the naval base to Gold Coast and take the kids out there for a picnic supper, but we just headed back to the trailer house and cleaned up and ate supper at the trailer, and then we all watched Coal Miner's Daughter on cable television and went to bed after that was over. We had tried all weekend to contact Chuck Steensland to find out where we were supposed to meet him Monday morning. He wanted us to meet him before he went to work to get the keys for the gate and the boat so that we could take our tours Monday from, just start out from his boat and walk up into the Washington Mall area. But we never did get a hold of him, and I told Dan and the boys we'd just go ahead and pack everything up and go up there Monday, as if we knew that we were going to spend Monday evening with him and go ahead and tour the city and just call him at the office. But we called the office Monday morning when we got up, and Chuck had called in to work sick. He sounded real bad when he called the week before, so I figured he probably was sick, and we just decided not to drive up there. We were going to go up there anyway, but I woke up with a headache, and Brian wasn't feeling too good, and Dennis was just plain tired, so we decided just to spend a relaxing day, because Troy and Carol were at work, and Amy and Jason were at some of their friends', so we just stayed in the trailer and rested and enjoyed ourselves. And we'd offered to take Troy and Carol out to a seafood supper that evening so that Carol wouldn't have to cook for us again. She wasn't really planning on us being there. But about 5 o'clock, Chuck called, and he wasn't sick. He had left a message at the office to tell us that he was late getting back to town. They had gone down the river to bring a big 40-foot boat up with a friend of his, and they had trouble getting it through one area. In fact, it was that Lookout Point that we were at Sunday. He was down there about the same time we were, and he said that all weekend he was wishing he had a phone number to get a hold of us, because he would have picked us up either in the Lexington Park area, or if he'd have known we were at Lookout Point, and the boys could have ridden up on this 40-foot boat cruising all the way up to Washington, D.C., instead of having to make that hour-and-a-half ride in the car, which they really would have loved. But Chuck had left our phone number on his boat and couldn't remember Troy's name or the name of the town or any way to get a hold of us. So we packed everything up and stopped at the grocery store and went up to meet Chuck. We met him over by the Lincoln Memorial Monday night. I guess it was about 8 o'clock when we rendezvoused there, and I wasn't sure I would recognize him and hadn't seen him for 17 years, so we had to give our descriptions by what we were wearing and watch for each other to flag each other down. Brad had seen him 2 years ago, and of course Chuck hasn't changed much at all, except he doesn't have his crew cut he used to have, so he wasn't hard to recognize, except he was riding a motorcycle and had on a motorcycle helmet, so I wouldn't have known him except that he told us what he was riding and what he was wearing. We went on over to Chuck's boat that evening, and it was in the marina that we had driven by the two other days that we were up in the D.C. area, so that's where we thought he might be. And he took us out on his motorboat and gave us a tour of the D.C. area. Thank you. and he wasn't sick. He had left a message at the office to tell us that he was late getting back. He told us what he was riding and what he was wearing. We went on over to Chuck's boat that evening, and it was in the marina that we had driven by the two other days that we were up in the D.C. area, so that's where we thought he might be. And he said goodbye to Carol at work and picked up some groceries and things from there. We went to Don Slade's, and they were going to have supper. Don got home at 5:30. They were going to eat at 6. And it was a little after 5 when we got there. And his wife Kay and the kids were there, and they just have a beautiful house and a gorgeous yard. And Kay is so nice, and the kids are so well behaved. But the boys, I think, were so much more relaxed there than they had been for a while. The house was big enough with a nice family room, and Don had his own operating pinball machine like you would find where it costs you 25 cents a game. I mean, a real nice pinball machine there that kept the boys entertained for a long time. And there was a bike for Brad to ride with a baby seat behind, so he was taking, I guess it was Don's little girl, Heather, for a ride on that. Ian, their boy, who's 6, Ian is 6 and Heather's 4. Ian was riding his own bike, and then Heather would ride behind Brad. And Kay had fixed, she had grilled steaks out on the outdoor grill for supper, and then she had corn and warm biscuits and strawberries. Chocolate cake was dessert. She had baked beans, lemonade, just a real good supper. The boys ate real good. Everybody ate good. It was nice to have a good hot sit-down supper. We'd done an awful lot of picnicking and sandwiches, and oh, I guess we'd hit a McDonald's and a Wendy's and a, I guess it was a hamburger and cheeseburger quick food thing that we had there at the Air and Space Museum with Chuck, too. So it was kind of nice to have a full meal for a change. The second night we were at Troy and Carol's, she had fixed a delicious roast beef and mashed potato and gravy and green beans and, oh, just a delicious supper. It was real good. And then one other night, we had had Italian spaghetti at their place, but the rest of the time it was strictly picnicking while we were on the run. Over at Don's, after supper, he got his motorcycle out, which has a sidecar on it, and gave each one of us individual rides in that motorcycle with the sidecar. So that was a pretty special treat for the boys, too. And then after supper, Don fixed popcorn for everybody, and we sat up and visited until, I suppose between 11 and 12 o'clock again, and he had to get up at 20 after 6 this morning, so we got up to see him off before he went to work. I guess we got up about a quarter to 7, and Kay had fixed pancakes for everybody for breakfast and had filled our cooler with ice water for the trip back, and we still had some groceries with us for our picnic meal. And it was about, I guess 20 after 8 by the time we got away from Slade's. And just like on the trip down, we started out with 70 degree weather this morning, and it's been hazy and cloudy all day. Just a beautiful, cool day, except for maybe an hour, maybe 2 hours this afternoon where the sun was shining real bright. But when we pulled into the motel this evening, it was clouded over and cool. We stopped at
back at 1717 Carlton Way. This is Carl that lived down the street that loved the dogs and the animals so, Jimmy Patton, Booger, Skipper, Shelley Flickinger and Janet Flickinger, Brian, Stacy Fullerton, Shelley Flickinger,
take a camera along, so Dennis had to stand back down and hold the cameras. Before we went up to Chuck's office, we went up to see if we could get Brian's hand checked, but all the doctors had gone home at 4 o'clock, and like I said, it was 4:30 when we finished with the tour. So Chuck said that he would run him over to one of the hospitals after we met back at the boat. We got back on the subway right in the rush hour, which it really wasn't all that bad, but everybody got off work at the Pentagon at 5 o'clock, and that's right when we were leaving. So Chuck had gotten back to the boat. He